So I want to open up this now to your questions. So.
I think there'll be plenty of questions. I see some, and we also have, since Casper sent out a page before, there's even some anonymous questions we may get to. But why don't we take...
You sort of wound up talking about happiness. Would you say that you are happy?
Me personally? Well, you know, it's like a... You know, it's a weird thing of language to have a word like happiness. When your reality in the day is for 3 minutes you're happy, then for 3 minutes you're anxious, then you get a phone call, and you know, happiness is never lasts for like, oh, for 3 days I'm happy, you know. But overall, I'm very lucky and very blessed with my lifestyle in being able to write these books. So if I had to say, am I happier than I was? Yes, I'm much happier than I was before I had a success as a writer. Yeah.
So piggybacking on that question, you're a classicist, so I have to ask, you know how to control men, and you know how to control women, God bless you. Mm-hmm. But
I don't know about the latter. Okay, go on.
But what makes the good life?
The good life?
Is it power?
Yes, because with power comes a degree of freedom. Now, I don't, you know, everybody's an individual. Some people like a position of dependence, and they feel happiest when there's somebody taking care of them. But ultimately, I'm not happy with that, because I know that that person will eventually withdraw their support. That unless this is someone who I'm going to live with my whole life, that's a different question. That eventually I'm going to be left alone, and that dependency, that love or happiness that came from someone else, I can't really 100% depend on it. So I want to be able to have it depend on something that comes from within. And I want to have it, you know, even to love somebody, even if you're going to live with them, is almost a skill that you have to develop. And it has to come from within. And the only thing that's of value is something that you develop yourself through your life experiences, through maybe some hard times, where you learn how to seduce, you learn how to compromise, you learn how to be in a relationship and how to love. And then once you have that skill, or whatever you want to call it, then nobody can take it away from you. And you have power, and you have freedom, and a degree of happiness. I don't know if I answered your question.
But what would the intrinsic goodness to you be? What's your intrinsic end of the power?
Well, there is no end, because we die, and what can I say, you know? I mean, that's the absurd human condition that we have. You can accumulate millions of all the money in the world and all the beautiful women, and then it's gone at some point. So I don't know what your question would be.
Those people that opt out of your system, can they not achieve happiness because they don't have that liberty? The people of the first case that aren't just that.
Well, I think that it's hard to gauge, and you can't put a number on it. But I think people who are depressed are often depressed because they have no control over their lives. They have no control over their destiny. They feel helpless. They feel like at work they might lose their job any moment. Now it's a terrible feeling. They feel that their children aren't listening to them. The man or woman that they want to have a relationship isn't listening to them. That sense of helplessness, to me, is the worst feeling in the world. And obviously there's a quote you've all heard of, absolute power corrupts, absolutely. Malcolm X had a comeback to that line that I like a lot more, and he said, absolute powerlessness corrupts even more than that. I'm not quoting it correctly. But the sense the sense of being powerless is much worse, more debilitating on the human spirit than the few people who are corrupted by having power. I still don't know if I've answered your question.
Although I wonder whether part of your question is, what do you use the power for? Is power the end that you're searching for?
Oh.
Or are there things you actually care about trying to, you know, use, you know, to have it make sense to bother to have power for?
Well, it's an interesting...
I'm not sure if that's your question, but that's mine. So.
Yes. No, I didn't... Yeah, that's my fault. I didn't understand. Well, you know, let's say I could talk about myself. You know, the pleasure that comes for me is in writing a book, and in writing the book well, and in spending a lot of time in getting it right, and understanding the real world as it is, the power game, the seduction game, whatever. And then creating a book that goes out in the real world. So half the game of life is doing something that you love and engaging with it deeply. And it's your study, it's your field, it's whatever you produce. But that's only half of it, because if you don't understand the social part, then the book that I write, if I don't know how to deal with people, and I don't understand human nature, and I can't market my book, and my editor hates me, and my agent doesn't know how to work with me, I could love my book, but it won't get out there, it won't get published, it won't have success, and I won't be happy. So it's the fact that the end in life is doing your work that you love and feeling satisfaction. But my experience is a lot of people in this world are talented, and they don't succeed because they don't understand that there's this other side of life, the power game, the Machiavellian game. They fail at it. And they might be a great painter, a great musician, a great business idea, but we're never going to hear of them because they don't understand this. And so to answer your question, the end is the satisfaction that you get with your work, for me. But that can only come with a larger understanding of the social component.
It's interesting because you succeeded in a way at these goals because you were powerless. You know, at least in the vignette that you gave, it was your own experience. You couldn't accomplish what you wanted to.
Right.
That started getting you thinking about how
That's
you
right.
accomplish it. That has now put you where you feel like you can accomplish it, which is right. And, you know, for you, it was somehow that experience of this extreme powerlessness
right.
that became the focus of your book and
yes.
and what you cared about getting. Get out of there.
And not to compare myself to 50, because I can't, but it was the same thing with him. When he was shot, he was very depressed, nearly died. He's sitting in bed. He can't talk anymore. He can't sing anymore. He can't go back to the streets hustling because they're going to kill him. The record label dropped him. He had experienced extreme powerlessness. And out of that, he analyzed what it was that he needed to do, and then he reemerged. So maybe there's something to what you're saying.
So you said earlier that it's only when we step out of Yale that we will see this other dark, the other side, and the need for this Machiavellian intelligence as you describe it. But we will be stepping in another type of society, and Yale is a society. Now, why is this different? What like, do you say that? Here's a place where there is no need for that, and we are blinded, kind of. Why did the master say the master sees tomorrow, so he could ask you a question today?
Well, how much, you know, at a place like Yale or any university...
So then you wouldn't show up. You would fail.
Well, I mean, at a university, let's say your goal, more or less, is to graduate with a very high GPA, as high as possible, and land a really great job, perhaps, out of this. To get those high grades, do you need to have Machiavellian skills? Usually not. Usually, professors they're not immune to favoritism, to being emotional. So there is a degree of seduction and charm going on. You could charm your professor, perhaps. But more or less, you're being graded on what you've accomplished. Now, you know, that's how life should be, and I wish it were that way. And I wish talent and getting answers right and doing a great essay. I wish that was the whole component. It would be a beautiful world if it could be like that. But it's not how it operates. And so all I'm saying is the element of ego and gamesmanship and politicking, how much does that enter into your goal of success at the university? I don't think it's as much, nearly as much, as one experiences in the real world. And in fact, the university, and I could be wrong here, but in fact, it tends to breed the opposite idea, which is why I think so many people suffer in life. It breeds the idea that just doing the good job and getting the good grades and succeeding is what will translate into power in the world. And it actually, learning that that's not the case 100% can be quite traumatic. So, I don't know.
Isn't that interesting that a lot of Yale graduates who go out and be in a lot of positions of power, as you might call it, is it very controversial?
How do you mean?
What you just said that over here, kind of, there's no need for that, so there's no profit for it. Nevertheless, after graduation, as I said, those people be involved in the described society end up doing well because of the characteristic, the character, they develop the education that they got over here.
Well, the education is extremely valuable, and I don't mean to devalue it at all. It's extremely valuable, and the skills that you learn, the analytical skills, the knowledge that you gain will be very valuable. But it's just part of it. And, you know, maybe your connections at Yale and the degree, it's very, has a lot of weight to it, and it can lead to a good job. But then you're on your own, and your personal, interpersonal, political skills were not developed at Yale. Now, there's this university called CalArts in California. I have friends who've gone there, a very interesting place. It was a school that was formed in the 60s, essentially. And basically, it's an art school. And they determined that the art world, there is no more political, crabby, competitive, mean-spirited world than the art world. It is because what makes a great work of art or film is very subjective. And so there's a lot of politicking. And they created this university to literally train their students to be good at that. And so they created this thing where you had to learn how to deal with your professors and deal with the politicking and talk about your work in a way that would charm and seduce and actually develop the kind of political skills that you're going to need when you later go into the art world. Now, that's kind of a unique thing for a university and very interesting idea. Yeah.
When you talk about the importance of expressing individuality.
Yeah. I'm sorry, I didn't hear the last part.
What if just following your own ideals means excluding yourself from the crowd and not giving yourself attention for it?
Following your own ideals,
yeah.
You know, means that you have to separate yourself from the crowd.
So which one would you say is more important, being unique or being able to mix with?
Well, they don't necessarily have to be mutually exclusive. And I didn't get to go into my idea in as much depth as I would like to. I don't mean that, you know, the moment you graduate Yale, you dye your hair green and you start, you know, doing something really wild because that's just who you are. That's ridiculous. And it's often not really who you are. It's just because you're trying to rebel and be different. It's more subtle than that. And so, for instance, we all have to serve an apprenticeship in life. So once you graduate Yale, you're going to go work for some high-powered law firm or Wall Street or wherever you go. I don't know. You're not going to have the luxury of suddenly not fitting in and being so weird and different. You're not going to last very long if you do that. You have to be able to take your time and fit into the culture that's created and find your place in it. But the problem is that that ends up becoming the end in life. You end up becoming a kind of person that only knows how to fit in, that only knows how to fit into that particular culture. And if you do that long enough, and now you're there and you're 30 years old, and that's the only thing you've ever learned to do, you're afraid to step away from that. You're afraid to express something unique about yourself. And so you have to, when you're in your apprenticeship, in those first years working at that high-powered firm, you have to be constantly waiting and for that moment when you're going to do something different. You have to cultivate your own individuality, your own self-reliant skills. People who now, and particularly in business, who are successful, are creating really unique kinds of business. There are new models being created every day. And so if you're having to think about that's the end game in life. I want to be an entrepreneur. I want to create my own business. You can do that from within a large corporation for that apprenticeship phase while you're learning about the world and you're preparing for that moment when you're going to step out on your own. But all I'm saying is if you end up becoming the kind of person that only knows how to fit into a corporate culture, that's going to be the end of it. That's as far as you're ever going to go. And if that's what you want, that's fine. But power lies in a slightly different direction.
So let me ask one of the written-in questions, and then maybe we'll have time for two more after that. People talk about the importance of charm and charisma. Uh-huh. How can these traits be defined? And do you have to be born with them? And I assume implied in the latter question is, what do I have to do to get it?
Well,
how do I learn to be charming and charismatic? Or can I?
Well, the answer to your question is you have to read The Art of Seduction. Because I describe 9 types of seducers in the world. And one of them is the charmer, and one of them is the charismatic. And they're different people. They're different types. And you can, usually charmers are not charismatic, and usually charismatics are not necessarily charmers. They're almost not the same. Charismatics are people who have a tremendous need to get love from the world. They don't want love from one person. They want it from an audience. They often come from backgrounds that are a little, they didn't have happy childhoods. And so to sublimate this need for affection and love, they turn to a large group, and they become charismatic on a political, on a global level. They become a Mahatma Gandhi, a John F. Kennedy. All charismatics are burning with a mission, with an idea that makes their whole face light up, their eyes light up, with this idea that they want to convert people to. And this sense of being alive with this inner fire is what people feel is charisma. Seduction is a nonverbal language, which is why I know it's The Art of Seduction is written with words, but it's a language that's nonverbal. You can't tell people you're charismatic. You can't communicate it outwardly. They have to feel it in an animal way. So in the book, I say, some people are born with charisma because they come from bad backgrounds, like Marilyn Monroe, who's an orphan. You're not necessarily from that background, but you can learn the idea of your inner conviction is what people feel. They see it in your hands, in your eyes. Like 50 has charisma. I've watched him. Everybody feels it around him. You have to have that inner conviction. Your whole body has to be alive with it, or you're not going to have charisma. You can learn to a degree, but there's a limit unless you're not born that way. Charm is a whole more possible realm for everyone. And charm is knowing how to please other people. There's a famous quote about a woman who said, sitting next to, this is about Gladstone and Disraeli, two British politicians of the 19th century who were rivals. And she said, sitting next to Gladstone, I thought he was the most brilliant man in the world. Sitting next to Disraeli, I thought I was the most brilliant woman in the world. That's the charmer. The charmer is somebody who knows how to make the other person feel great about themselves. And it's a really important social skill. It means not thinking about yourself, but imagining what the other person wants to hear, what their weakness is, what they need validation. You have to be outer directed. And it's very important and very powerful, and anybody can learn it, and I talk about it in the book. So seducers are not born, they're made. And you may not end up becoming Cleopatra, but you can go halfway or a quarter of the way. Did you want to ask another anonymous question?
No, let's go over here to get two more from the crowd. And then
you mentioned entrepreneurs, and yeah. I also heard from a lot of entrepreneurs that they say that in order to be wildly successful, you have to be prepared to wildly fail.
Yeah.
And does that fit into sort of your paradigm of
very much
power, and how so?
Very much so. I'll be looking a lot about that in my next book. All of the most creative people are experimenters who have many failures. Einstein, who I've been reading a lot about, he said, I measured my success by how full my wastebasket was. How many ideas I threw away meant that I was on the right track. If my wastebasket was empty, I wasn't being creative. You're going to be measured by your failures, and the reason is we learn by doing. You can't learn how to run a business. You can't learn how to have success by reading a book. I'm afraid I'm just dissuading all of you from buying my books. But ultimately, a book has a limit. It's your own experience in doing things where you learn, this is what connected with my audience. This is what got that guy interested in my idea. And so you have to go out there and be not afraid of trying things, starting a business. They've shown entrepreneurs that I don't know the number, but it was like 95% of them, their first ventures fail. And the ones who are successful go on to a second and a third one and a fourth one. They're called serial entrepreneurs. So you have to not be afraid of failure. You have to be the kind of person that tries things out and learn from your experiences. And if you're afraid of that, it's going to be very difficult to gain the kind of real-world knowledge that you have that you need in order to have success. So it's very important.
So you talk a lot about personal characteristics like charisma, aggressiveness, etc. But, 50 Cent wouldn't have been able to sell that mixtape if the environment wasn't ready for it.
Yeah.
And there's that French minister who survived from the French Revolution all the way through Napoleon and after.
Tolerant.
Who just,
Fouché.
Fouché, mm-hmm. Noted just the ebbs and flows and trends. What do you think about the, like, aside from personal charisma and characteristics at all, about the natural way that opportunities and political opinions sway with the time?
Well, it's a good question because, a lot of people will say, they look at a Clinton or Barack Obama and they'll say, what makes them so brilliant or how do they succeed in an election? And a lot of it, a good degree, is luck. You come on the world stage at the right time. So there is always a degree of luck in anybody's success. I met this man in Italy. If I didn't have met him in 1995, I still might be slaving away in some cubicle in Hollywood, and you would never have heard of me. I had the luck to meet this man. But the difference is, everybody has luck. Everybody, something happens to you. It's just, what do you do with it? Are you the kind of person that recognizes the opportunity? When Barack Obama was first deciding to run for presidency, it happened to be a lucky moment where this was probably the only moment where he could have won an election, given his background. But he was the one that recognized this was the moment, and I'm going to seize it. When everybody was telling him, you're not ready to run, you need to wait 4 more years. And he said, no, I see this as the opportunity. So what separates people in life are a good thing will happen to you and you let it pass. If you're an opportunist, which I talk about in the 50th law, you recognize that opportunity has come and you work like a fiend in order to make it happen. So when this man gave me the opportunity to write the 48 Laws of Power, I worked night and day, my birthday, Christmas, 365 days a year till 1 o'clock in the morning. I was not going to let go of my one opportunity in life. And that's, to me, what separates people who take an opportunity like that and others who let it slip by. Yeah. Did that answer your question?
It does.
Okay.
So let me make a comment and then get your reactions, and then I think we'll sort of finish up. You know, I know when I first started looking at some of what you wrote and hearing you today, it would be easy to take much of what you say as instructions for how to use other people, how to get them to do your bidding. And there's clearly a way in which much of the laws are written that way. And that's a very, you know, sort of instrumental view of other people. How do I turn them into means, you know, for me to accomplish something. Also, though, mixed in, as you've talked and as we talked earlier, you know, I had a sense that some of what you're really interested in is something that, say, some of the psychologists here and our provost here to study, which is emotional intelligence. How do I understand how other people think and what moves them and what their emotional state is and how my actions will interact with theirs, and that having some honed emotional intelligence might put me in a position to be able to accomplish things that I want, but also be attuned to what they want, and not necessarily treat them as means, but treat them as, you know, as their own independent entities. And so I was wondering how you think about those tensions.
It becomes tricky because if you're thinking about them deeply in their own needs, where is the distinction for them becoming a sort of a means to it? What are you trying to accomplish? If you're trying to, for instance, forge a political organization where people are all on the same page with a sense of mission, and you need to be sensitive to the kinds of people that will join your group, and you're aware of their own needs and the fact that they're an individual, but you're, on the other hand, you're bringing them into the group and you have a mission, you're trying to accomplish it, what separates them from being a means or an instrument and also being attuned to their individuality and what their separateness is? Why do they have? Why does it have to be mutually exclusive?
I don't know what they are. You know, I don't know that they are. You know, but I do think that the focus on sort of what's that other person's interest and what would really matter to that person and how might we both be able to accomplish what we both care about. You know, we get our goals in alignment. And go back to where you ran into the difficulty that you talked about.
Right.
The boss who, you know, squashing you. Was there another way than just to say, well, never outshine my boss, but to think, no, I shouldn't outshine her. How do I bring her over?
Yes.
But then it aligns with, you know, we both want to create, you know, these stories.
Well, yes, and I mean, in the book, in the 48 Laws of Power, I talk about how you do not outshine people and get them, but then it gets very Machiavellian. You know, it's a good point because people mistake my books for being purely about how to use people, and it's all kind of selfish. But particularly in The Art of Seduction, I make the point that you're not going to get far unless you are a kind of person that knows how to think inside the other person's mind. And that requires a totally different kind of personality, where you have to kind of not be so self-absorbed, where you can think inside of other people and what their interests are and what's going to appeal to them. That's the secret to being successful as a politician or a business person or in any kind of relationship. And I go as deeply into that as I can, but not many people recognize that because they only see the element of using other people for what you want. So.
Yeah, well, that's what I was aware of.
Right.
So you do have that component, but it may not be the most visible. So,
yeah.
But I wanted to thank you very
much. Oh, thank you very much for
that.
Thank you.